Heavenly Father, we want to say thank you. We know that many were alive last Sunday, but today there are no more. And this is why we are giving you all the glory concerning our lives. We say a big thank you for gathering us together again today to learn at your feet. Lord, even as we have come to learn from you, Daddy, we are asking of you to teach us in the language that we will understand this morning in the name of Jesus. Let your word fall on fertile ground in our hearts in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Daddy. In Jesus' mighty name we have prayed. Our lesson this morning is lesson 12. But last week we learned something about grace. It is by His grace, part 2. Was the lesson of last week. And the memory verse was taken from 1 Corinthians 4:7. 1 Corinthians 4:7. Can somebody read the memory verse or say it to us? Or can somebody? You don't have books? Yes, sister.
Now, if you indeed receive it, why do you boast as if you had not received it?
What's the meaning of that? We were taught last week. That's pride, simply put. Why should we boast of anything when we are not the author of anything? Why? Even your children, you think they belong to you. No, they don't belong to us. We are given. So, why on earth would we have to boast over anything at all? Instead of boasting, we should be giving all the glory to God, the author and the finisher of our faith. And last week we learned we had two outlines, causes of pride, and of course, the results of pride. What are those things that cause pride? All the little things of the world, when we pick them together, we begin to walk in the air. And all these things will get destroyed. Moth will consume them. They are useless. They are worthless. When somebody dies, what happens to the certificate? All the knowledge that fellow has acquired perishes with him. Why boast? So causes of pride, wealth, knowledge, success. Who can mention one or two as you learned last week? Yes. What again? Position and seeking attention and recognition. And of course, it has a reward. Pride must be rewarded. You know what? God hates pride with passion. He can't stand it a bit. The moment you are a child of God and you go to the ministry of pride, God begins to look the other way until you come back to Him. Praise the Lord. So destruction is the reward of pride. May we not be destroyed in Jesus' name. Even before the visible destruction, it will bring shame. Destruction is just the ultimate. Let's just leave it there. This morning, we are going to look into that topic of that strong man that is behind you and who you are and what you have and everything. And that is God Himself. We already know Him, and that's why we are all gathered here. The topic is God has no equal. God has no equal. Since you were born, you were once young, and now you are old. You have been in the third world, now you are in the first world. Have you ever seen somebody that is equal to God? Have you ever seen anyone as great as God? Oh, there is no one that is equal to God. No one at all. Ah, Daddy, we give you all the glory this morning. Because we are even too small to teach him. I don't know. He has to help us through. We have a song. And it doesn't matter how far we go this morning, but I believe that God will show himself to us individually. So I need you to sing that song before we start the lesson of today. Please, can you beam the song for us? Salamide, the choir, help me. There's no other God like the living God, like you, the living God. I need you to sing that song. If you don't know it, just follow the word and follow us. So if you understand that, the lesson of today will be as easy as eating moi moi. If we just understand it and we'll finish it like that. Yes. There is no other God like you, the living God. There is no other God like you. You sit on the throne in the midst of all the cherubims. There is no other God like you. You Anybody is harassing you, just laugh. Because it's going. You know, God is a rock. Anyone that hits that rock, what did the Bible say happens? Ground into powder. There is no equal at all. That's our God. And we are going to look at it this morning. Okay, before we start looking into the Bible, we want to look at the memory verse for today. It's taken from 1 Chronicles 17, verse 20. 1 Chronicles 17, 20. 1, 2, go. Shall we take it? Oh Lord, there is none like thee. Neither is there any God besides thee. According to all that we have heard with our ears. 1 Chronicles 17, 20. Some of you, I don't know what is wrong with your mouth. We are talking about God here. And we are talking about how he has no equal here. And we are talking about he being the person you depend upon. And you cannot say the memory verse. Please open your mouth and read the memory verse today. 1, 2, go. Oh Lord, there is none like you. Neither is there any God besides thee. According to all that we have heard with our ears. 1 Chronicles 17, 20. Now, does that make any sense to us? Okay. I don't understand the meaning of that memory verse. Please lift up your hand so that we can explain it to you. Okay. Now, our text this morning is 1 Chronicles 17:16-21. 1 Chronicles 17:16-21. I need somebody to read it for us.
And David the king came and sat before the Lord and said, "Who am I, O Lord God? And what is mine house that thou hast brought me hither here?" And yet this
just hold on, sister. Has it ever happened to you when you are so surprised at the move of God in your life? And then you look at yourself and say, "Lord, who am I? Why are you showering this much blessings upon me? Who am I? Do I worth what you are doing for me?" What is that? Thank you. Next verse. This is exactly what David is doing. He just sat down and looked at himself. Say, now, wow. Look at what this God is doing for me. Verse 17.
And yet this was a small thing in thine eyes, O God, for thou hast also spoken of my servant's house for a great while to come, and hast regarded me according to the estate of a man of high degree.
He said, you have not only showered your blessing on me, even when I am gone, you are still leaving words behind for my lineage. How do I come to deserve this, God? You understand that? Okay?
What can David speak more to thee for the honor of thy servant? For thou knowest thy servant. O Lord, for thy servant's sake and according to thy own heart, hast thou done all this greatness in making known all these great things?
What's the meaning of that? What can somebody help us? I've been talking. I want somebody also to just wosem that for us. To translate that, to explain that to us.
Can we go back to the 19 again?
Okay.
O Lord, for thy servant's sake, and according to thy own heart, as thou done all this greatness, in making known all these great things.
Who is saying that? What do we have in that piece? Yes, but it's still expressing some things.
That God has blessed him according to his own heart.
You are doing all this just because of your love. So much love. Yes, next one.
O Lord, there is none like thee, neither is there any God beside thee, according to all that we have heard with our ears.
That's the memory verse. You still remember that? Yes. There's none like him. Yes, next one and the last
one. What one nation in the earth is like thy people Israel, whom God went to redeem to be his own people, to make thee a name of greatness and terribleness by driving out nations from before thy people.
Hallelujah.
Whom thou hast redeemed out of Egypt.
He's still in the work of redemption. He's still redeeming people. And we are the Israelites, aren't we? Aren't we the Israelites of today? And he's still doing wonders in our lives. He's still rebuking nations. He's still rebuking our enemies, and he's still going extra mile for us. This is the God we are talking about. I don't know what you have done to deserve what he's doing for you, but as far as I'm concerned, I don't know why he's doing it, because I do not deserve any of his grace that he has given upon me. Hallelujah. Yeah. So today, we are looking at God, how great he is, and it's just one of him. There's no other one. No one is equal to him. Who is this God? How can we describe him? Of course, how can you describe him, ma? Just one word, and you go. One word. Okay, that's a good one. Yes. Wonderful. Talk. How do you powerful, brother? All in all. You know what? Whatever you call him is what he is to you. So, that's why we don't even have enough. What is it that we have? Is it intelligence, I should call it? We don't even have enough sense. Our brains are too small to understand his greatness. We cannot, because we are limited. We understand it when we get to him. So, but this morning we are going to look at him from two areas. We're going to look at him in the area of his glory and his names. And you have called some of the names. And we know so many names that we call him when we worship him. So I believe that will be a walkover. But his glory, he always comes down in glory. And he does that in this church. Every Sunday he comes down in his glory. So can we describe this glory that we are talking about? He will help us. He will help us to understand. So we have two outlines for today. One says, no co-equal in his glory. Even if President Biden should come in this minute, you cannot begin to pour the accolades that you pour on God on him. You can't call him immortal. You can't call him ancient of days. You can't call Biden the Almighty God. You cannot. Is that possible? No. So, God has no equal. His glory, no co-equal in his glory. No one can take that. That's one of the outlines. Then the second one is no equal in names. Name, the name of God. Sometimes it intoxicates me when I have to use it. And I see the result. The name Jesus is the key to life. There is no name like that name. When death hears that name, what does it do? He runs away. He flees. He can't just stay because he is God. So, his name, there's no equal. That's why we say we can't call Biden the ancient of this. We can't call him the Jehovah Rapha, the Lord that healeth. We can't even call the biggest doctor in this land Rapha. No, God is the only one that healeth. Praise the Lord. The matchless glory of the Almighty God can be likened to devouring fire on top of a hill, dark and thick clouds, typical of his secret place and pavilion. We are trying to look into the glory of God. When they say the glory of God, what is it? How did it happen? In that bush that was burning and not consumed. I need you all to help me. Exodus 40, 34, 1 Kings 8, 11. Just open onto those Bible passages ahead of me. Can somebody read Exodus 40, 30, please? Can you beam that very quickly? Technical, I need you to be very fast with me this morning so that we can take a number of 40. Exodus 40, verse 34. Cloud. God, his glory shows forth in cloud. It does. You read how the pillar of fire, and what again? The pillar of cloud. Sometimes when he wants to say hello to Israelites, they will just see the cloud resting upon the tabernacle. They say, ah, Baba has come. That is the glory of God. The glory of God is not all the time that it shows forth in cloud. God can decide to show his glory in any way he decides. So we cannot pin him to that cloud. Now, 1 Kings 8:11
says, so that the priest could not stand to minister because of the cloud, for the glory of the Lord had filled the house of the Lord.
Hmm. When the glory of the Lord is in a place, you will know. In this instance, the priest has no strength to stand. He goes down because of the presence of God. Praise the Lord. And sometimes when we are worshiping here, you see everyone just doing their thing according to the dictates of the Spirit. The pastor will come. He will not be able to do anything but to continue worshiping and worshiping and worshiping. He lost control because of the presence of the Holy Spirit. Do we understand what we are saying? Praise the Lord. Share your experience if you have with us. Sister Juma, you have any experience to share? So the Spirit of the Lord manifests in cloud. When he comes, when his glory comes down, he's in control. He does. And when the glory comes down, you know that the glory of the Lord is down. We need to tap into that. Because he visits at that time. Our whole life is like a billboard before. He knows each and every one of us. At that time, that's not the time to be looking at Sister Ore and be looking at Brother XYZ. We're talking about the glory of God. Praise the Lord. When Moses saw it in the bush and he was looking, and he got to know what he was into, he surrendered. Praise the Lord. Now, God does show his glory to his children. It is possible for you to experience the glory of God in your private or on your private altar. Brother Caleb was telling us a while ago that we need to have our own altar where we meet with God. If we don't have that, brethren, we are goners. We are just playing. We don't know what we are doing. So we decide to come to our own sanctuary. Where is our altar, our heart? He comes, he visits. If you have not experienced that, just try harder, a little bit harder. He will come. He surely will come. Pastor was describing it for us some weeks ago, that when you get to that point, you can't talk. You can't say any meaningful word. No utterances. Utterances can fail you. But you will speak, but you won't just be in control. That's what we are talking about. When the glory of God is in, when one is in the presence of this glory, you don't have control anymore. Am I lying? Okay. Please, if you have anything to say, just because I'm teaching here with so much difficulty this morning, because I don't know what to teach you. Yes. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, they cannot. No, it's not just possible. They cannot. Thank you. Sometimes it comes, you have heard some people say, I saw that light. I just saw the light. I can't describe the light. The glory of God also can come with indescribable supernatural brightness. It comes that way, that you just want to continue looking and looking. You can never get tired of looking and wanting to know what is behind the light, but the light is warm and it envelops people. We are talking about the glory of God. May we all continue to experience the glory of God in the name of Jesus. And it is beautiful for situation. Very beautiful. Supposing somebody has a problem, what kind of problem is big now? Tell me a problem that is big. Huh? A problem that is big but can have solution, or you think may not have solution. Just tell me one. Huh? No money. That one is not too big. Sickness. Especially when the doctor has attached a label to that sickness, an expiry date. A sickness that has no expiry date. And it says, get ready, in the next 6 months, go write your will. And then you pray. What else can you do? What else can one do than to pray? And then the glory of the Lord comes down, and one sees that bright light, and you felt that an old man lay, you just saw a hand, you won't see everything. And he says, don't worry, I will not leave you, and I will not forsake you. Now, what do you think will be the effect of that in the life of somebody that has gotten a death sentence from a doctor? He will just be looking at that doctor, saying, you don't know what you are saying. If he says, I'm with you, I will not leave you, and the doctor is saying, you will die. Of course, the situation has turned around. Is that not so? It's now for us to wait for the manifestation of it, which may take time, it may be immediate, may take 3 months, 6 months, but the word has been declared. The Lord said it. I believe it. And that settles it. Yes, ma'am.
I just want a clarification because my mind has just been kind of thinking of various.
Make that
things.
Clarification very fast, okay. Because we are short of time.
So we've been talking about grace for a while, and now we're talking about the glory. Grace we cannot physically see, but we know that God is doing something. The glory of God, most times, is it appearing. Is that what it is? It's appearing, like it might come, like you said, in different forms, like a cloud, like what you were just illustrating now, like somebody talking to.
Sometimes you don't see nothing. You just feel his presence.
Okay.
You will know that in this atmosphere, the Lord is there. You will just know it.
But you begin to see the manifestation. There will be anointing.
Yes.
People will start. So that's what I'm trying. That's the thin line. So you begin to you feel it, and you begin to see the manifestation. But grace, on the other hand, we know he's there. I'm just trying to clarify. I just had it in
what
back
kind
of
mind. Are they supposed to be compared?
I'm grace not comparing. And,
okay.
I'm just trying to.
Okay.
Let me not further waste your time. Let's go. Maybe later on we can.
No. Please say it.
We don't have time.
The Lord will help
us. No, it was just going on in my head.
Yes.
You know, because I know
grace.
We've taught grace for 2 weeks now. You know, we've been talking about the grace of God. You know, and that's the manifestation
yes.
of God.
Yes.
Now we're talking about the glory of God. And it's still the same God. But when it comes to the glory of God, do we see more physical manifestations? Like it comes down like a cloud. There's
does.
Anointing.
Yes,
there's
there
this, there's that.
Yes, yes,
so,
yes.
But it's still the same God.
Yes, you are right. Anybody has anything to say to that? She's right. What she has said is right. The grace is with God.
I think the grace
to give. Okay. The presence is with God to decide when to throw it to us. Praise the Lord. Yes, ma'am.
Grace is readily available. It's readily available to anybody that wants it. But for the glory of God, you have to seek it. You have to seek and pray for that glory to come.
You are right.
I was going to say that, you know, we're talking about grace. So grace is, when we learned about it, is a deposit. It's something God, you know, releases. The glory is Him. So it's not something He's going to release to you or deposit in you. It's something He reveals to you. You know, like you said, you are in His presence, and then you it's a feeling. You feel that the atmosphere is different. The physical manifestation, I think it depends on God. The physical manifestation might be there, and it might be something that would be reflective later. For Moses, people actually saw that the glory was there. For Moses, when he encountered God at the burning bush, there was really nothing other than the fact that he heard God audibly. Nobody else could see what was going on when after, but later on we could see that, you know, there was an encounter there with God. So I think it's up to God how He wants to manifest that glory or chooses to. But the grace is a deposit, but the glory He can't deposit. It's like you said, sometimes we need to seek that glory. Sometimes He chooses to reveal Himself.
Yes, sometimes. Yeah. Thank you. Yes, ma'am.
Also, with grace, it is unmerited. Like everybody's been saying, it's something he can give if He chooses to. But, I mean, with the glory, you have to ask for it. When you talk about Moses, remember before God told him that you are on holy ground. You need to take off your shoes, which shows that you have to be holy. You have to be in His presence in truth and in spirit before he can give that to you or show you His glory. If you are not in the right space, atmosphere, holy, seeking Him, seeking His face, you will not see His glory. You can shout till whenever, and you can scream to whenever, but if your altar, which we have said is your heart, is not one-on-one with Him, you will not see His glory.
Okay, thank you. Let's simplify that. Now, let's say the grace is the free, I mean, the is the benefits we do enjoy as citizens of America. Good light, water, and all that. Now, the presence of the president and his entourage coming to visit you, and you being able to shake his hand, touch his clothes, and have a word with him, can we say that is the glory? So Biden can go wherever he wants and do whatever he needs to do. But once you come to America and you comply, you can enjoy the grace. You can enjoy the benefits of America. Is that simple enough?
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you.
And Biden doesn't go anywhere. Anyhow.
Yes.
That is the grace. You got to be there before he come to visit you. The importance of where he goes.
Let's just even assume that you can say, oh, Brother Mutiu, I've heard so much about you. I'm coming to your house. You know, your whole street, your whole neighborhood, and they know they will want to be partakers in that. Praise the Lord. And that's why on the 31st of December, whosoever will come to church will also will enjoy the glory of God. And say, eh, what is this? I'm just coming from my club. I've not seen this kind of before. So that can entice him to want, I mean, to be a beneficiary of grace, because he wants to join us. Is that clear? Yeah, we spent a little bit of time there. We're still talking about the grace of God. I mean, sorry, the glory of God. He does it the way he likes. He can decide to give thunderous speeches. He can do it anyhow. His glory. Okay. Let's take another Bible passage. Let's take Psalm 19, verse 1.
Psalm 19, verse 1. Mm. The heavens declare the glory of God, and the firmament showeth his handiwork.
Any, is that in dispute? Does the heaven display, does it display the glory of God?
Yes.
What can you, can we name 1, 2, 3? Thank you. So, heavens displays it. And wherever he is manifesting his glory, you will see his splendor, his majesty, his strength, his beauty. You will see him. I don't mean, you will just feel God, his presence in his everything, his totality. Some people will begin to cry, and they don't know why they are crying. They will just be crying, until the pastor will pacify, the shepherd will pacify them and say, what is the problem? And that problem will be solved from there. So, it also can be likened to a decoration of floor with golden carpet. I don't know if we do produce golden carpet in the world. Have we seen golden carpets? Does anyone have golden carpet in his or her house? Okay, that kind of carpet is a little bit higher than what we have here. Anything beautiful, beyond us, wonderful, awesome, that words cannot just describe is what we feel when the glory of God is on. There's no living person or any lesser God that can bring that effect to anywhere. And that's why we say there's no equal to the glory of God. Praise the Lord. We will run through his names. Our book classified the names used in the Old Testament and the New Testament. In the Old Testament, it's called the I Am That I Am. Moses said, you are now sending me to Egypt, and I will come to your people, and I will say, the God of your father said, we get out of here. And when they ask me, who is this God, what should I tell them? God says, I am that I am. What's the meaning of I am that I am? Our time is fast spent. I don't know how we are going to explain each of these names today, but maybe we will have to research on our own. I am that I am. That is, I that I have been before the world. I created the world, and I am still God. I am that I am. That is, nothing ever changes with me. I am the same God. I am that I am. Praise the Lord. I am the one that made you with clay. And when it pleased me in the New Testament, I took some sand, I spat on it, and I still did my thing with sand. I have not changed. I am that I am. You know the meaning of that name now? I am that I am. Nothing changes about me. I am. Just tell them I am. May he manifest himself as I am that I am in our lives in Jesus' name. He is Jehovah Jireh. Genesis 22:14. Please just open any of those verses. Genesis 22:14. I am that I am. Jehovah Jireh. Jehovah Jireh is the great provider. Abraham, sacrifice your son to me. Okay, Lord. And then he saw a ram. He provided for him. And he said, oh, this God is a great provider. Jehovah Nissi, the Lord our banner. He fights our war. He fights our battles. He's the banner over us. Jehovah Shekinu, the Lord, our righteousness. I'm going to rush through. Please dig into these names and know the meaning. The Lord, our healer. You all know that. He heals. He's called Jehovah Rapha. Jehovah Mekadishkim. The Lord our sanctifier. He's the one that can purify us. He's the one that can make us righteous so that we'll be acceptable unto him. Jehovah Mekadishkim. Jehovah Shammah. The Lord is present. Jehovah Rohi. The Lord our shepherd. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. So then we have let's leave those Old Testament names. And we look at, we have other names like Alpha and the Omega, beginning and the end. The Great Physician, we saw it in the Old Testament there, Jehovah Rapha. The Rose of Sharon, and so on and so forth. He's our advocate. He's everything. All his names are not contained in this book. And these names are problem solvers. These names are great keys. We should not suffer because we have these names. Praise the Lord. The name of Jesus is I am that I am. Because he was there before creation and he's still there. Praise the Lord. That's how far I can go. I'm so sorry. So the Lord will continue to manifest his glory. And his glory in our lives in the name of Jesus. Shall we pray? Everlasting Father, we thank you for the little we are able to take today. And we pray, Lord, that you expand it in our hearts in the name of Jesus. We are hungry and we are thirsty for you. Daddy, meet us at the point of our need in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Daddy. In Jesus' name we have prayed.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Ayo, and it is my pleasure to welcome you to RCCG, the House of Prayer. And in case you don't know, this church is shepherded by Pastor Tolu and Pastor Mrs. Fumi Mackinder. Here at the House of Prayer, we devote the body of Christ one soul at a time for his kingdom. If this is your first time worshiping with us online or in person, we want to welcome you to the family. We pray that you be blessed as you worship the Lord with us today. In Jesus' name, amen. Psalm 119:105 says, "Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path." We pray that as you listen to the word today, that it ministers to your heart. Enjoy the service.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
Are you happy to be in God's house one time this morning? Amen. Sing, oh,
oh, be lifted above all other gods. We lay our crowns and worship you. Oh, be lifted. Oh, glorious God.
The Most High. We are in the presence of the glorious King, the God that is indescribable, the God that is so holy, the God that is so powerful, the God that you can never describe. Begin to praise this God. Begin to praise Him. Begin to lift up His holy name. Begin to exalt Him. He is worthy. He is glorious. He is an excellent God. He is a good God. He's a God that is above whatever we can imagine. It is a God that cannot be quantified. It is a God that is above other gods. Oh, Father, we praise you. Oh, Lord, we praise you. We magnify your majesty, Daddy. Oh, Father, we come before you this morning. Oh, Lord, we lift up your holy name. Oh, thank you, Father. Thank you for the grace that we experience. The grace that we have in your name. Oh, we thank you, Lord, for your grace that has been sufficient. Your grace has been sufficient. Your grace has been sufficient. We thank you, Lord, for your mercy. Be so merciful to us. We give you praise. We give you adoration. We honor you, Father, Lord. Let your glory come down. In the name of Jesus. Oh, Daddy, we thank you. Father, we thank you. We thank you, mighty God. It is not our alarm clock that woke up this morning. It is you, Lord. We thank you, mighty God, for the blessing of sleeping and waking up. Oh, Daddy, we thank you. It is not by our might. It is not by our power. It is because of you and all that you have done. Oh, Lord, we glorify your name. We glorify your majesty, Lord. Thank you, our Ancient of Days. Thank you, our King of Glory. In the name of Jesus. Thank you, Father. For in Jesus' mighty name we are praying. Brethren, our God is a great God. He is the Almighty King. From everlasting to everlasting, He is God. He knows the end before the beginning. Before we started 2022, He already knows the ending. He knows He will keep us. And He has kept us from the beginning, even until today. And He is faithful to keep us throughout this year. In the name of Jesus Christ, we are going to ask you and pray that, Father, I thank you for you are my way maker. I thank you, Lord, for you are my way maker. You are my miracle worker. Thank you for working out my ways. From the beginning of this year, you have worked it out. Oh, Lord, I thank you for all that you have done, for all that you have made possible. Oh, Lord, I thank you. I thank you for your power, for your protection. Mighty God, I praise your name for all that you have made possible. Thank you, Ancient of Days, for being our miracle worker. Thank you for being the mighty man in battle. In the name of Jesus Christ. Oh, we know we have many battles. But Father, Lord, you are the one that fights them for us. I thank you, King of Glory, for all that you have made possible. In the name of Jesus. Father, we glorify your name. In Jesus' mighty name, we are praying. We are going to ask the Lord to cleanse us of all unrighteousness. In any way that we have been shut or that we have not acted according to His glory, according to His will, we're going to ask the Lord Almighty to forgive us, to wash us by the blood of Jesus. The blood that was shed for you and I on that cross of Calvary. He went to the cross. He despised shame for you and for me. He died for you and he died for me so that we can live, so that we can have life, so that the enemy will not triumph, we will not triumph over us. So we are going to thank the Lord. Father, Lord, we thank you. Thank you for your cross. Thank you for the blood you shed. Father, we pray that you will cleanse us. Cleanse us of all unrighteousness. In the name of Jesus, as we go before you today, in today's service, mighty God, we pray that your blood will make atonement. In the name of Jesus, anything that is not of you, mighty God, we command them to bow. In the name of Jesus, we command them to give way. In the name of Jesus, in our lives this week, oh Lord, we pray that you will take charge, that you will take all the power. In the name of Jesus, Father, we thank you. We glorify your holy name. In the name of Jesus, thank you, Ancient of Days. For in Jesus' mighty name, we are praying. Today, we are reading from the book of Psalms. And the Lord laid on my heart to again to use Psalm 125. In these times that we're in, we need to trust in God. We need to trust in his ability. We need to trust in his almightiness. We need to trust in his power. Because there is nothing we can do of ourselves. There is nothing we can even say that will be positive that God will not put in our hearts. So we are going to read Psalm 125. And I pray that we can all read it together powerfully in the mighty name of Jesus. So we go now. They that trust in the Lord shall be as Mount Zion, which cannot be removed, but abide there forever. As the mountains are round about Jerusalem, so the Lord is round about his people, from henceforth even forever. Do good, O Lord, unto those that be good. Sorry, for the rod of the wicked shall not rest upon the lot of the righteous, lest the righteous put forth their hands unto iniquity. Do good, O Lord, unto those that be good, and to them that are upright in their hearts. As for such as turn aside unto their crooked ways, the Lord shall lead them forth with the workers of iniquity. But peace shall be upon Israel. Peace shall be upon you. Peace shall be upon the house of prayer. In the name of Jesus, we are going to use this scripture. It says, they that trust in the Lord, they shall be as Mount Zion, which cannot be removed, which they will abide forever. But if we look properly, he says that yes, they shall be as Mount Zion. But to be as Mount Zion, we have to trust in God. We have to put our trust in him. To put our trust in him, we must put our trust out of every other thing. In the name of Jesus, it is only by God's grace that we can do that. By his spirit that we can do that. That we can remove our trust from other things and from other areas and from other people. So this morning we are going to pray, Lord, give me the grace to trust in you. In the name of Jesus, grant me that grace to trust in you alone. In the name of Jesus, let me not trust in man. Let me not trust in systems. Let me not trust in economy. Let me trust only in you. King of glory, we pray. In the house of prayer, our trust shall be in you alone. In the name of Jesus Christ. Oh, Father, we thank you. Ancient of Days, we glorify your holy name. In the name of Jesus. Thank you, Father. For in Jesus' mighty name, we are praying. He says that they shall be as Mount Zion, which cannot be removed, but abided forever. Mount Zion has been there over 3,000 years ago. It is still there now. It has not shifted. It has not moved. It is still the same Mount Zion. And we're going to pray because the enemy is still in the business of removing people from their rest. Is he in the business of removing people from their rest? Removing them from their joy. Robbing people of their joy and of their rest. So we are going to pray this morning that in the name of Jesus, Father Lord, don't let the enemy remove me from my rest. In the name of Jesus, from my rest I shall not be removed. From my joy I shall not be removed. In the name of Jesus, for what you have done for me, mighty God, the enemy will not remove me. In the name of Jesus, God, I will not be cast out. In the name of Jesus, for I will abide forever. In your presence, I will abide forever. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Father, we thank you. We glorify your holy name. In the name of Jesus. Thank you, our King of Glory. For in Jesus' mighty name we are praying. Verse 2 says, as the mountains are round about Jerusalem, so the Lord is round about you. We learned this morning in Sunday school that when his glory comes, sometimes we can perceive it. Sometimes we see it physically. Sometimes we don't see it, but it is there. But that when that glory comes, that we should always tap into it, because the Lord is there. And whatever it is that we are asking, that is the moment to lay ourselves, to empty ourselves of ourselves and be with the Lord. So we are going to pray with this scripture now, that as the mountains are round about Jerusalem, God created mountains to surround the city so that no enemy can infiltrate. No enemy can come without them even knowing about it. So we are going to pray, Lord, please fortify me in the name of Jesus. In this year that we are going, Father Lord, before the end of this year, Father Lord, we pray in the name of Jesus that you will protect us. Protect our children. Protect our joy. Protect our rest. In the name of Jesus, protect our careers, our jobs, our businesses. Oh Lord, protect us. Every investment in the house of prayer, they are protected. In the name of Jesus, the enemy will not steal our joy. In the name of Jesus Christ, thank you, Father. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. Verse 3 says, for the rod of the wicked shall not rest upon the lot of the righteous. You are all righteous. In the Lord Jesus, you have been made righteous. By the reason of knowing him, you are righteous. And the Bible says, the scripture is saying that the rod of the wicked shall not rest on you, and it will not rest on you. We know those that he rested on. Jabez, he was a righteous man, but the rod of the wicked rested upon him through his mother. His mother proclaimed and named him a name that is not decent. Let us put it like that. Because she bore him in sorrow. But he carried that until he opened his mouth to talk to God, for God to change his story. And God answered him. So this morning, what is that mountain? What is that mountain? That mountain that is flexing the muscles. What is that mountain that is boasting? Boasting against your God. Who is that mountain? Is it in your job? Is it in your career? Who is that mountain? We are going to pray. Father Lord, every mountain, Father, in the name of Jesus, Father, remove them for us. In the name of Jesus. Oh Lord, remove every mountain. In the name of Jesus. You answer Jabez. Father Lord, answer us. You are the God that answered by fire. Father Lord, answer our prayers. In the name of Jesus. Every mountain before anyone today, by the reason of your glory, by the reason of the blood you shed, Father Lord, we command them to be removed. In the name of Jesus. We stand here together as a body of Christ, and we command every mountain before anybody this morning, be removed. In the name of Jesus, be removed. Be removed. I say be removed in the name of Jesus Christ. Thank you, Father, for in Jesus' mighty name we have prayed. We know what happened to King Hezekiah. He trusted in the Lord. As we are trusting in God now, he did the same thing. The king of the Assyrians, they came against him. They have taken over every nation except Judah. When they came, King Hezekiah went to God. He went to God and he cried out to God. What did God do? Before they came to begin the fight, God sent his angel to visit them. He visited them and he used only one angel to destroy 185,000 soldiers that they didn't even have the chance to come and attack them. So we are going to pray this morning that, Father Lord, because we trust in you, any enemy that is planning any attack against anyone here, is it through alcoholism? Is it through pornography? Is it through any other means of the enemy? Father, we come against it now. In the name of Jesus, send your angels, Lord, to deliver us. In the name of Jesus, you did it for King Hezekiah. Father, Lord, do it for us. In the name of Jesus, thank you, Father. in the mighty name of Jesus. Thank you, our Ancient of Days. We give you all the glory. We give you all the praise. We give you all the adoration. And Father, as we go, oh Lord, we pray that you will grant us your rest. Grant us your confidence. Oh Lord, grant us, mighty God, everything that you have promised us. Fast track your promises in our lives. In the name of Jesus, as we go into this week, mighty God, let our testimonies be bucket full. In the name of Jesus, let there be bundles of testimonies. In the name of Jesus, of your goodness, of your mercy, of your kindness. You are a good God. And Father, we praise you. We magnify your name. As we go into this service, Lord, please take control. In the name of Jesus, everyone that will be ministering, Lord, we commit them into your hands. Let your glory descend upon them. In the name of Jesus. Thank you, Father. For in Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Good morning, church. I want you to welcome everybody around you right now. Welcome them into the house of the Lord. Tell them good morning. And you are privileged to be sitting, standing next to me this morning as we give God praise. Hallelujah. Let's get ready to give our God praise in this house. Amen. We love. voice and say,
you.
heaven. Let's say, I believe. Come on.
I believe
in you. Say, morning, just raise your voice and start to worship him. If you believe in your Father, you believe in his power, you believe in his strength, we believe in who he is, we believe in his greatness.
You are my increase.
You are
worship you today. Oh, you are more than enough.
You are more than enough. I worship you today.
Let's say you are the potter.
You are the potter.
Come on. And I am the clay.
I am the clay.
You are the strength of my life.
You are the strength of my life.
You are my peace.
You are my peace.
And I declare you are my helper.
You are my helper.
You are my God.
You are my God.
You are my helper. Yeah.
You are my helper.
Hey. You are my God.
You are my God.
Oh, oh, oh.
Jesus.
Hey.
Jesus.
Worship him this morning. Let's just adore him. Let's exalt his holy name. Let's worship him and say, Father, you are indeed more than enough, and I worship you this morning. I worship you because you are the all in all, the King of kings. You are the almighty God, the one that was and is to come. The same yesterday, the same today, the same forevermore. The one that has kept us alive up till this morning. The one that has watched over us from the beginning of this year, even up to this 13th day of the month of November. I want us to worship him. I want us to exalt him and tell him that he's indeed more than enough. He's indeed more than our protector. He's indeed more than our provider. He's indeed more than we will ever, ever, ever expect of a father. Yes, Almighty Lord, we worship you this morning. We exalt you, we magnify you, because you are indeed more than enough. And this morning, in humble adoration, we bow before you. Oh Lord, we bow before you and worship you this morning. And worship you because you are our all in all. the King of Kings, and there is none that can be compared unto thee. There is none that can be that is equal to you, Lord, because as we have learned this morning, that there is no co-equal with you. And so, Mommy, Lord, Father, we worship you. We exalt you, we magnify you. Blessed be thy name, O Father. Exalted be thy name forever and ever and ever. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. Amen. Can we please put our hands together for the choir? A couple of weeks, I said from here that I'm expecting your album. This morning, I said the same thing again. We are still expecting it. And I pray that the Lord God will indeed bring out from one voice that album that will be used, will be for his glory alone in Jesus' name. Can we all have our seats? Briefly. Amen. But sorry that I'm going to have to do this. That's why I said briefly. Can you look to your right and to your left? Or maybe you should look first to one side. I don't know which side you are going to look into. But you are going to say, thank God we survived the midterm elections. Hallelujah. And then you are going to look at the other side and say, by his grace, I'm going to survive many more midterm elections. In the name of Jesus. We're laughing. I don't know about you, but it was something I prayed about. You know, Brother Caleb and I, we usually connect every Saturday. I won't say more than that. But clearly to pray, all right? I mean, and that was the prayer he took when we met yesterday evening. Because the Bible says that we should pray for those in authority. Because it's true, when we have prayed for the right people, he said we will be able to live quiet and peaceable lives. So that's why I said, I was telling my wife yesterday that I prayed. And whatever has come out of it, I believe it's the answer to prayers. And I encourage us that we should continue to pray. I mean, most of us, except for our children, are originally not from this place. My daughter will always say she's an American. And I say, yes, it is true. Me, I'm a Nigerian. So we call her American-born Nigerian. But me, I'm a Nigerian all through and through. I'm from Africa. And an unapologetic one for that matter. Amen. All right, so we're continually praying. And we pray for Nigeria too. We pray for those of us that are from Africa. That God will continue to do that which only is able to do. So before we go on, I want to find out, are there anyone, people that are worshiping with us for the first time today? Any first-timers in our midst? Tommy, for sure, for it. Can you please, anybody that's around there, can you please help us welcome them? Welcome them properly, the T-H-O-P way. I say they are welcome in the name of Jesus. You're welcome, sir. You're welcome, ma'am. Just sit down properly. You're in the presence of the Most High God, your Father, that has brought you. And I pray that the first time miracle that he has prepared for you will not miss out of it in Jesus' name. So, I mean, we like to praise God here. I hope you have enjoyed it thus far. But like I said, just sit down. You are still going to enjoy more. The best is yet to come in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, having done that, we are going to do one more thing. We're going to pray for our children before they move into their own classes. Can I have all our children up standing? Hallelujah. I'm tempted to do what pastor does, but since I'm not a pastor. Okay. Please all come. Every one of you come out. Bless you. Move to this side too. Move to this side. Move to this side. So let's display the faithfulness of God upon our lives in the house of prayer. Are they not all looking glorious and gorgeous? The glory and the faithfulness of God upon our lives in the house of prayer. I want us to do what we always do. Let's stretch forth our hands towards our children and say that this ones will be our greater tomorrow. Can we all be outstanding? Let's pray for them and say that these are our children, they will be our greater tomorrow. In the name of Jesus, that the devil will not take them away from us, that the evil one will not have his way upon their lives, that this one that he has given us to as blessings, they will remain blessings indeed. And where we could not get to, that he will take them there. He will take them further. He will take them higher. And that any time and every time we look upon these children, it will be for good. And that any time and every time we look upon these children, we will see the faithfulness of God in our midst, upon our lives, upon their lives, in the name of Jesus. And that this ones too, as we are praying, that they too will be used powerfully and mightily in the USA and beyond the US. That this ones, they will be men and women of substance. They will be men of timber and caliber all the days of their lives. And that by the time that Almighty God will call us yonder, we will look back and say, Father, you have indeed been good to us. Father, Lord, we pray for our children. We say, Lord, this one, I want us to pray that they will not die young, and that they will fulfill purpose and fulfill the counsel of the Most High God alone all the days of their lives. Yes, oh Lord, we pray that these ones will fulfill counsel. They will not die young. They will live to declare your glory upon the land of the living. In the name of Jesus. Thank you, blessed Redeemer. In Jesus' precious name, we have prayed. Amen. Can you please now go to your classes? Thank you very much. So let's just wait for them for a couple more seconds. Hallelujah. Once upon a time, it was just a few seconds that we need to get our children out. Now it is not a few seconds anymore, it is some minutes. And we thank God for his goodness. Hallelujah, yes. Please clap for the Almighty God, because he's the one that has done it. The Bible says, this is the Lord's doing, for it is marvelous in our sight. Amen. I forgot to mention something. So at some point, later in the service, we'll welcome you properly again, and then we'll share a bit of about the house of prayer with you. Yes, the last part before we go into the word. So, I mean, you can see that the pastor is conspicuously absent from his seat this morning. He's out of town, but he's here in spirit. I won't be surprised if he's watching us right now. I trust him. I'm not surprised. All right. So if you are watching, Pastor, we are missing you, but we know that you are okay where you are. Just make sure you bring something good back for us. Amen. So even though he's not here, he has prepared a vessel to bring the word to us. I've been opportune several times to sit under this vessel of God. And I always wonder how she's able to bring out the deep and secret things that he brings. I mean, sometimes I'm like, I don't know how she does it, but clearly it's because God speaks to her. All right, and that's why she's able to do such a good thing. You know, they always say that behind every successful man is a woman. I permit me to change it to say that beside every successful man is a woman. It's not behind. God didn't make or arrange it that way. It's beside. I mean, every Pastor Yide is sitting beside Pastor Junior. It's not. So is Pastor Shola. Why am I saying so? By the grace of God, the success that we have seen here is because of the person God has put here, Pastor Tolumakede, and beside him, to make the work easy, he gave him his own wife, the bone of his bone and the flesh of his flesh, to make him much more successful. All right? I'm sure you already know where I'm going. Great. You people are all in the spirit. Amen. Like I said, she's a woman of God, a faithful servant of the Most High God, a lover of the Most High God, a lover, you can say, a lover of children. That's one of our soft, in fact, that's our soft spot. Oh, okay. always look forward to hearing her speak. And I hope you are looking forward to hearing her speak again today to bring the word. Can we all be upstanding and put our hands together as I welcome to the podium Pastor Mrs. Fumi Makinde.
The honor belongs to God, the keeper of our soul, our preserver. To him be all the glory, to him be all the honor, to him be all the adoration. Thank you, Lord Jesus. If you don't mind, sing this song with me.
You are bigger than what people say. Jehovah, bigger than what people say. You are bigger than what people say. Jehovah, bigger than what people say. Some say you are good, you are kind, but bigger than what people say.
With me to Proverbs. Can we project it? Proverbs 4, 20 to 22. Proverbs chapter 4, verse 20 to 22. It says, my son, attend to my word. Incline ears, thine ear unto my saying. Let them not depart from thy eyes. Keep them in the midst of thine heart. For they are life unto those that find them, and health to all their flesh. I want you to say a prayer. Say, Lord Jesus, I pray that I will attend unto your word today in the mighty name of Jesus. And be willing to learn from you in the mighty name of Jesus. I want you to say that your word shall not escape my sight. In the mighty name of Jesus. But it will live in my heart. In the name of Jesus. Your word shall be life unto me. In the name of Jesus. Healing and health unto me. In the name of Jesus. I want you to add anything that the Lord laid upon your eyes. A heart concerning that verse. That the Lord will open your eyes of understanding. In the mighty name of Jesus. Thank you, my King of glory. Thank you, my Lord of hosts, for in Jesus' mighty name we have prayed. Please be seated. God bless you. The topic of today's sermon is unknown sin. Unknown sin. This is one of the hardest sermons I've ever had to write. Because it hit me from a place that I never thought it could hit me. Have you read the Bible several times, back and forth, and missed something from the Bible? But when you finally now hit it, the Lord tell you, I'm talking to you. Yeah. And I said, but this does not have anything to do with me. Yeah, there's one thing in there that has to do with you. When I read it, and we'll read the verse shortly. When I read it, it pinched me. It bothered me. I could not sit still. I was cranky the whole day. Because there was a sin that was unknown to me that I was committing. It is hard. And when it hits you like that, you are like, oh my goodness, me? How can this happen to me? I'll show you what when where it hit me, where it has to do with me in the verse. I want you to open with me to Ezekiel chapter 16. Ezekiel chapter 16, 48 to 52. There were, even while we were doing this, the Bible reading for the year, I know a couple of people are here that read the Bible for the year with us. But when it came to this verse, Ezekiel chapter 1 to 16, I did not comment. I didn't make any comment. I was silent in the group because it affected me individually. I'm going to go ahead and read. Can we project it up? Amen. Ezekiel, let's have the Amplified version. Amplified version. It says, as I live, says the Lord God, Sodom, your sister, and her daughter have not done as you and your daughters have done. Behold, this was the sin of your sister Sodom. She and her daughter had arrogantly abundance of food and careless ease, but she did not help the poor and needy. They were haughty and committed repulsive acts before me. Therefore, I removed them when I saw it. Furthermore, Samaria did not commit half of your sins, but you have greatly increased your repulsive act more than they. So you have made your wicked sister, Samaria and Sodom, appear righteous and justified by comparison to all the disgusting things which you have done. Verse 52. Also, bear your disgrace as punishment, having made judgment favorable for your sister, for you virtually absorbed them because of your sins in which you behaved more repulsive than they. They are more in the right than you. Yes, be ashamed and bear your disgrace, for you made your pagan sister seem righteous. This is a tough verse to read. Now, you cannot claim to have a relationship with God and still claim to be have a broken relationship with others. You cannot claim to worship and love God and treat God people as if they are less than human. You don't have to agree with me, but it's actually written in the Word. The first four commandments of the Lord talks about your relationship with God, you loving God. The next six is about your relationship with one another. He's not talking to people in the world. He's talking to believers. And we as believers, we're obligated to love one another. It's not, it's not a choice from afar, but we are obligated because it's part of our requirement. Praise the Lord. I'm getting there. Now, back to the verse, Ezekiel 16, 48 to 42.
This was around 587 BC. The children of Israel, they were, the children of Israel and Jerusalem were conquered by the Babylonians, and they were under the rule of Nebuchadnezzar. But when they went into exile, they were wondering, how can this be? How can a loving God, so loving, do this to us? Have you ever been in a situation and say, how can this happen to me? But I'm a child of God. How come they were under that captivity. And they get to, they ask this question. So while they were under the captivity, the Lord sent Ezekiel to them to go in the midst of that captivity to explain why. And the why is what we see over here in that Ezekiel. But before that, he explained the why went on from chapter 1 to chapter 16. But the main thing was actually in that chapter 16. He said because they were full of pride. They had fullness of food, but yet did not attend to the poor. That they had abundance of idleness. And the last one, which is the haughty and spirit and abundance of abomination. We're going to go to each and every one of this to explain it. Now, this, he compared them to Sodom. But when he compared them to Sodom, we know Sodom's sister, Gomorrah, correct? I was like, why compare them to Sodom? We know them as for the abomination. But it is beyond that. We focus so much on the abomination, like men should not be with men, women should not be with women. But if you read deep into that verse, that was not the first issue that God had with them. Matter of fact, it was like the fourth or fifth. It was beyond that, because we're so quick as Christians to say that that's what it's about. No, it's not. It's beyond that. And we're going to, it lets us know that even though it's beyond that, that if we ignore it, we ourselves, may that not be a portion though, can be held captive. May the Lord help us in Jesus' name. Let's go through each and every one of them. The first one was that they were full of pride. They were full of pride. They did well for themselves. They built buildings and they did, you know, a lot of things. But they did not attend to the poor people. They were bragging of what they have, what they own, what they have achieved in life. Does that sound familiar? Let me just bring it home. We might be doing well in America, but back home, maybe a parent or someone is suffering. You cannot be bragging and looking good over here, yet it neglect those that are needy. It reminds me of the rich man and the poor man. You know, we studied about that in Digging Deep. But I saw that he's someone that is actually a believer. But yet he neglected the poor man that was by his way. So we cannot neglect those that are suffering and say that we're doing well for ourselves. Another thing that was that where this is because it's not, we look at it as just pride. It's not just pride. How many of us go to the gym? Paid for a year of gym. How many of us actually attend the gym? Only Brother Caleb. So we pay for that, but they keep on taking that money. And yet, you know, there are people needy that need that money. If you know you're not going to go, why pay? So there are things in our lives that we spend money on that we could actually be helping the needy with. Praise the Lord. So that's what that reminded me of. They have accomplished a lot, but they neglected the poor. Another thing, which is the number two, and this is, before that, let me give you some verses that would help you. Let's go to Proverbs 16, verse 1 to 6. Proverbs 16, verse 1 to 6. It says, the preparation of the heart belongs to man, but the answer of the tongue is from God. All the ways of man are pure in his eyes, but the law weighs the spirit. Commit your works to the Lord, and your thoughts will be established. The Lord has made all for himself, yes, even the wicked, for the day of doom. Everyone proud in heart is abomination to the Lord. So even though it's there, it's still an abomination. It says, though they join forces, none will go unpunished. So let's keep this right there. Let's move to the next one. The second one is the fullness of food. This is where it affected me personally. This is where it pricked me personally. You know, sometimes when we have a gathering at church, extra food is left over. They sent it, you know, home with me, and I take it, put it in the fridge, and I cook. How many of us cook every single day of the week? We have no choice. Yeah, cook that, put it there. One day, which is the day before this happened, I had to grab a trash bag out of the underneath the sink. And do you believe me? The spoiled food, the leftovers, that the food and the food that the kids refused to eat filled up in that trash bag. That is a sin. It pricked me because I have a job to do as a believer, to make sure I'm not wasting food. Because did I give to the poor that week? No, I did not. But yet, I'm wasting it. These are some of the things that they were guilty of. And they do it constantly, constantly, constantly. And they neglect the poor. It's so important that we understand that just because we are blessed, we should not forget about those that are less fortunate than we are. Because there, you know, even that week, someone asked me, oh, can you send money back home? I the first thing that was on my mind, how many times have I sent? But I'm not, that's not my job to judge. But yet, I have the audacity to waste those food. You see where I'm coming from? This is what they, because we look, this is what bothers God. May the Lord help us in the mighty name of Jesus. God has a word for us concerning the poor. He says in Proverbs 28, 27, he says that he who give to the poor will never want. But he who shut his eyes will have many curses. I don't know about you, but I was uncomfortable. Very uncomfortable. And when the Lord said, for me, that's what I want you to preach on. I said, I walk this way. He said, no, come here. This is what I want you to preach on. And I said, but I have a lot of work to do. You start, even when you minister it, you start working on it. We're not perfect, but these are some unknown sins to us that we are not aware of. And that's why he held them in captivity. That's why he took everything away from them. Praise the Lord. The third is their abundance of idleness. Their abundance of idleness. The word idleness over there in the Hebrew is actually called sheket. And sheket means idleness of mouth. Meaning that, and this is where the Lord wants me to dwell on mostly in this message for you today. He said that Your mouth was closed in the things you should be talking about. The reason why America cannot tell us, can keep our mouth shut, is because we allow them. We say, oh, it doesn't pertain to me. As long as it doesn't pertain to my children whatsoever, I can walk away from it. And then it must not be so. As believers, we see things happen in the church and we shut our mouth. Things that are wrong, things that as the body, it needs to communicate. It communicates. I cannot move the leg without the head moving. We need to be able to tell each other the truth. We need to be able to correct each other, not ignore one another. The Israelite will see things happen and they say, well, it does not concern me. As long as I worship God on Sunday, that's the most important thing. But this cost them so much. And one of the reasons why it cost them so much is, why were they acting like that? Why were they acting like that? Because they were blessed. Because they are blessed. When you are blessed, you don't worry about other people. When you are so blessed, you say, if this person doesn't have the right, you say, what concerns me? And they'll find a way, they find Uber or whatever. It does not concern you. You go about your own business. When you're blessed and another child does something wrong, you say, what concerns me? And let the parents deal with that child. What's my own? Culture teach us to mind our own business. But God is telling you, no, you need to speak up when you see something wrong. You need to correct one another because we are still bride of Christ. And though the bride might not be as attractive right now, but when God is finished working with us, we become beautiful. We become attractive. We become that he would return to. Amen. So that's the reason why in the church, sometimes we say, I don't want to come to that church. They do this too much. They do that. No, you are also part of the problem. Because you say, I don't want to come. That means you feel that it's not your responsibility to change the church. The minute you step in here, it becomes your responsibility. Whether you're a walker or not. Not to leave it for them to do. God was so angry with them because of these acts. They feel so blessed. What pricked my heart even more? He said that they were worse than Sodom. Let me go over there really fast. Let's go back to that Ezekiel. He said they were worse than Sodom. He called them a harlot. He said, no. You are not a harlot. You're worse than a harlot. Because at least a harlot get paid for what they do. You pay them to use you. That is terrible. I don't mind you, we're talking about believers over here. As believers, we need to walk in the light. Walk blameless. Yes, the pastor might be responsible for the sheep, but you are also responsible. Anytime God shows you something, that means he wants you, not anybody else, to minister to that person. Not to have idleness of mouth and go and tell Hickey, Harry, and John what the problem of that person or that child is. I need to make this example. Our children are not here, right? Praise the Lord. I was so pleased with one of the brothers in the church. When he saw my son outside one day in the gas station, and his friends were misbehaving, but his friends got in trouble. And he took my son and, you know, he interceded and he talked to him. And then it didn't finish over there. He now called my husband and spoke to him. This is where I find him, though he is not the problem, but his friend, the people that he's hanging with, is a problem. My husband now told me, I was like, wow, that is a rare breed. Of course, we addressed the matter. But you know what he did? He changed the life of my son for the better. There are some things we as parents don't see that other people will see outside. And when my son talks about him, he looks up to him. And that is so important, because if he would have told everybody else in the church, not knowing even the situation, you know, told everybody, or ignore and watch from my side, or even better one yet, what do we do nowadays? We take a cell phone out and you just, you know, this is Pastor Solo. I don't know what he's doing with those boys, but he's probably among them. You know, that is part of idleness and idleness of mouth. As a church, we need to stand to correct, to protect our own, to not be a part of the problem, but to be a part of the solution. The reason why the church cannot speak out, because they're lacking these things. The church is so weak nowadays that the world is telling us what we can and we cannot say. In many cases, I sent something out earlier this week. We can't even call Jesus in certain places. We're not even free. We have to live by their own lies. So that's what the Israelite did. They started, you know, they became a part of the world. They claim they're not, but they became a part of it because they accepted. And I'm going to show you why I mentioned that. Because if we go back to that Genesis 19, we only see the abomination, that the fact that the two men wanted to, you know, be with the men wanted to be with the two men, the angels that, you know, came to visit Lot. But if you see just that, you've missed the whole picture. I'll tell you what I see. I see violence. Because it's not talking about gay love. No. It's talking about sexual violence. Not just against man, but also against women. It is not acceptable. This is shown everywhere, and we're still going through this right now. You see it in the Bible several times, but it's ignored. But God addressed it in that Ezekiel 16. Yeah, you see it also with Sarah having to be, you know, Abraham wanting him to be a sister. What if God did not intervene? God intervened. You see it also with Rebecca. Thank God, God intervened. But Isaac's granddaughter was not so lucky, which is Tamar. And so many others. Because when I get to that part in the Bible, I'm like shaking. I was like, how come they ignore? There was another part I was looking for. I couldn't find it. There was a time that, you know, they really abused some women in the Bible. And I was like, wow, this was ignored. It's not acceptable unto God. And God say, I do not accept that. We see this everywhere. And it cannot be ignored. How dare us ignore all that? As even Lot was complicit about the whole issue. And just focus on the other stuff. So it's beyond that. For years, I just focused on the homosexuality. But it's beyond that. It wasn't the number one thing on the list. It wasn't number two. It wasn't number three. It was down there by five. And it's so important that we as Christians open our eyes to these things. We cannot, number one, have that pride in us and be proud of what we have accomplished in life, yet ignored. I'll tell you what, there are some cases, even it's within, it's not even far from us. I say within because a man can be doing well and you look at his wife and you say, ah, is this the same husband to this wife? He is looking good, he's doing this, doing that. When you now see his wife, she looked like if she just came from the village. It must not be so. Because you are one. You must do things together. If you love God, you must love your wife. You must love the church. You must love your children. You must do right by God. Because for that is that if you can get your relationship right with God, you can get your relationship right with other people. Praise the Lord. I want to touch up on some of the abomination. I do not like touching, but I'll have you write some of the verses down. You can go home and see it. Some of them are really shocking. Praise the Lord. We have, we already know about the man cannot lay with man, women cannot lay with women, and that's in Leviticus 16. 21 to 25, and how we are not meant to defile ourselves. Also, you'll see it in Deuteronomy 22, verse 5. Another abomination that you might not be familiar with is lying lips. And that's in Proverbs 12:22. Proverbs 12:22. It says, lying lips are abomination unto God, but they that deal truly are his delight. Proverbs 17:5 lets us know that he that justifies the wicked and he that condemned the just, even they both are abomination to the Lord. I'm just going to touch upon a few. We already know about the proud heart is also an abomination to God, and that's in Proverbs 16:5. Proverbs 11:20 says that that they are of a forward heart are abomination unto God. Isaiah 1:18, incest. We already know that is an abomination. Proverbs 20:10. I'll let you read that. Deuteronomy 32:18. When it comes to your vows, you need to read that. Deuteronomy 23:18. Proverbs 15:12 says, the thoughts of the wicked are an abomination to God. Proverbs 15:8, the sacrifice of the wicked is an abomination unto God. If you want to give something unto God, I need to touch up on that a little bit, and you've been wicked to one person, don't bring it to. Very, very important not to do that. Deuteronomy 27:15. It says, cursed be the man that maketh any graven or molten image an abomination unto the Lord. And it goes forth. Isaiah 66:12. And Proverbs 29:27. I'm going to read this because it's somewhat of a quote. It says that, I read it. Someone sent it to me. It says that if we continue to live in sin, not only do we not know God, but we never knew him. There are so many illegal Christians nowadays. They are Christians by label and not by spirit. He says that, are we changing or are we the same people as we were last year? It's 2022, and if we are still the same as we were 10 years ago, we never grew and we never bore fruits. How do we bear fruits? By basically loving God and loving his people and having a relationship with them. Amen. There's another quote that I want to share with you today. This kind of touched me. He says, sometimes the devil allow people to live a life free of trouble because he doesn't want them to turn to God. He says their sin is like a jail cell, except it's all nice and comfy. They don't seem to have any reason to leave. The door is wide open till one day their time runs out. The cell slams shut and suddenly it's too late. This is what happened to the Israelites. How long more do we think God will allow us to continue to sin, to continue to lie, to continue to not help the poor? Don't raise up your hand, but how many has helped the poor this year, went above and beyond for the poor? Obviously, this has a lot to do with the poor, and it means a lot to God that we should care for his people. We should love. Look at that, the lesson of that rich man and the poor man. He was a believer. And if we even look, leave that one alone and went to go to the Good Samaritan, it's there too. The people who are believers will walk past him and not care. This is the reason why he destroyed their land. This is the reason why he destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah. This is the reason why he kept the people in Israelite in captivity for decades. Obviously, it's important. And the Lord God Almighty wants us to learn something from this today. It's not just about us. We have a job to do. We cannot be living lovely, but yet other people just in poverty. Praise the Lord. So they have got their why. I could just imagine after Ezekiel finished talking to them, you probably couldn't hear a pin drop. Because when people are saying, why is this happening to me? Their mouth is running to 20 miles. Why is this happening to me? But there's a job for us to do. I want us to rise on our feet and go before the Lord and plead to him. Because we might still be operating under grace and not know it. But unlike me, I was pricked. I realized where I've gone wrong. And that's why it's called unknown sin. Because it was not known unto them. They didn't realize that they were doing something wrong. They thought they were right standing with God. And they thought everything was okay. That's the reason why they have the audacity to ask God why. Has people given you advice and you've neglected? Has God sent them to you and you know that you were supposed to be right standing with God? Stop doing this, stop doing that, something like that. But you just ignore it, thinking you're right with God. I want us to go before the Lord and ask him to help us that we can be right standing with him. His word says in that Matthew 7:21, it says, Jesus said, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of God. Lord, have mercy. But only the one who does the will of God, the Father will make heaven. Is there an unknown sin? Maybe something out of the one I've read today that pricked you, that make you get angry. Is she talking to me? If that is one of those, then the Lord is talking to you. The Lord wants you to do something about it, just like he wants me to do something about the wastefulness of food. You're going to ask God to help you, that you'll be held standing. And you will not wait for the door to shut close before things become hard for you. You're going to ask God to help you. Help you and guide you. That the things that you ought to be doing, because obviously there's no salvation if there's no transformation. Say, Lord God Almighty, transform me today. Your word has been sent to me. I will not neglect it in the mighty name of Jesus. Every unknown sin in my life that you've revealed to me today, help me, Lord Jesus. Help me, Lord Jesus. Mold me, Lord Jesus. Help me, Lord Jesus. I know there's work for me to do, Lord Jesus. I will not repeat it. Lying shall not be my portion. Idleness of mouth shall not be my portion. Pride of the heart shall not be my portion. Father Lord, I will not have abundance and neglect the poor in the mighty name of Jesus. Speak to me, Lord Jesus. Help me, Lord Jesus, that I can move rightly with you in the mighty name of Jesus. Jehovah, I thank you. And I give you praise and I give you honor. Blessed be to your holy name, Baba. In the mighty name of Jesus. Thank you, my King of glory. I wanted to step down, but the Lord say for us to pray against every idleness of mouth, that's actually the cause of the weakness in the church. Is there something you have seen and ignored and refused to correct? Ask the Lord to give you wisdom in the mighty name of Jesus on how to address it, on how to go about it. It might not be even in the church, it might be among your other friends that are believers. Ask the Lord for guidance. Ask the Lord for wisdom. Ask the Lord for understanding. That as you speak to that individual, the Lord God Almighty will give that person in understanding in the mighty name of Jesus. Thank you, my King of glory. Blessed be to your holy name, Baba. Yes, Lord Jesus. The Lord said that there's someone here that has been corrected several times, but they ignore the correction. We're going to pray for understanding. In the mighty name of Jesus. Because this God that sent people has gone ahead of you. Father Lord, open our eyes of understanding. In the mighty name of Jesus. That every hindsight will be made aware unto us. In the mighty name of Jesus. That we will not ignore the main aspect of what we are trying to tell us. In the mighty name of Jesus. Thank you, my King of glory. Blessed be to your holy name, Lord. For in Jesus' mighty name we have prayed. Let us give the Lord a clap. He's worthy of all praise. He's worthy of all honor. He's worthy of our adoration. And so, our Heavenly Father, we thank you for this opportunity. the opportunity that you are able to send forth your word to minister unto us, to tell us some of the unknown sin that the Israelites I encounter that can also be ministered unto us. Father, Lord, thank you for this opportunity. Thank you for the boldness to be able to bring this word, because I know, Lord Jesus, I try to escape it, but you still remain God. Your word shall fall on fertile ground tonight in the mighty name of Jesus. Thank you, everlasting Father. Take all the glory, take all the honor, take all the adoration, for in Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen.
Please join me and let us stretch our hands towards the vessel of God. Let us pray for her, that the Lord Almighty will continue to use her, that the Lord Almighty will continue to put his word into her mouth, that her heart shall receive from the Lord Almighty in the name of Jesus, that all that she needs to speak, that in the name of Jesus, that his spirit will bring it out, in the name of Jesus, that Lord, that God will continue to teach her and send her to nations to speak his word. In the name of Jesus, pray for her. Pray for the vessel of God, that the word that she will speak will never return void. In the name of Jesus, that she will continually be the carrier of the Spirit of God, and that God will speak through her. In the mighty name of Jesus, that God will use her to touch lives. God will use her to reach others. Others that need that word, that needs to hear that word, that in the mighty name of Jesus, that she will continue to speak, that her voice will not be silenced. In the mighty name of Jesus. Father, we thank you for your vessel. We thank you and we pray that you will use her continually in the mighty name of Jesus. Thank you, Ancient of Days. For in Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. Amen. Let us give her another round of applause for God. For all that God has used her to do in the name of Jesus. Father, we thank you. Now it is time for our tithes and our offering. So what we're going to do, we're going to pack it together. And if you are giving your tithe, I pray that you will, that God will continue to bless you. And that you will lift that tithe up and ask God for one thing. One thing only that you want to talk to God about. Ask God. Talk to God about it. Use that tithe to speak to God. Because when we bring tithe to the house of God, we are only coming to thank him for what he has already provided. So it is out of his provision that we're now being obedient to his word. And also, if you are giving your offering today, we thank the Lord for giving seed to the sower. We pray that the Lord Almighty will continue to sow his seeds into us in the name of Jesus, and that we shall continue to sow in the mighty name of Jesus. Also ask God for what you want God to do by being obedient unto him. Our God, we learned this morning, is indescribable. You can call God what you think God is. That doesn't change who he is. You can call God money. He is money. So the money we give to him, he doesn't need that money, because he owns it all. So ask God, send that offering and that tithe, send it a message for what you want God to do, what you have been asking God for. Father, we thank you. We give you praise. Oh Lord, as we are asking, mighty God, Father, Lord, we know that you are a God that answers with speed. When your speed comes upon a vessel or upon a man, they are no longer ordinary. Prophet Elijah had to run the chariots of the king.
with his legs. Pray that God will grant you speed. He's a God that answers you by fire. Ask him to answer you by fire. He answered Prophet Elijah by fire. Ask him. He's able to do abundantly more than what you can ask. And Father, we thank you. Thank you, Ancient of Days. We give you glory. We give you honor. We give you adoration. In the name of Jesus. So I'm going to invite the choir to give us a song. A danceable song.
Amen. Let's rise up as we bring our offering.
Partaker of this goodness, of this blessing that you have brought into your house. Father, we thank you for everyone that you have used, mighty God, to contribute to the work of God. Father, we pray in the name of Jesus that you will replenish their pockets in the mighty name of Jesus. David said that he will not give to God what does not cost him anything. If you have given God your dance or your money, the Lord Almighty will answer your prayer. As you have prayed this morning, you shall be answered by fire. In the name of Jesus Christ. Father, Lord, we thank you that mighty God, that we will never lack in the name of Jesus Christ. Father, we praise you that we will bring more into your kingdom to advance your kingdom here on earth in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. And Father, Lord, we thank you. We give you praise. In Jesus' mighty name we have prayed. Amen.
Welcome back. We hope that you were blessed by that powerful message. Now let's get into these announcements. Are you in need of additional guidance? Is something troubling you and you can't seem to find a solution? Well, we've got great news for you. Pastor is available for counseling. Set up a time to meet with him, virtually or in person, and may be blessed as you do so in Jesus' name. Amen. Do you have a voice? Are you passionate about praising and worshiping God? Well, if you answered yes to those questions, we would love for you to join us and be part of One Voice. If you are interested in being part of this dynamic ministry, please see Brother Caleb at the end of the service. Happy birthday and happy wedding anniversary to all the House of Prayer celebrants this week. We pray that God will give you more reasons to celebrate in Jesus' name. Amen. Come fellowship with us during our weekly services. Sunday school begins at 10:15 a.m. and our wonderful worship service begins promptly at 11 a.m. On Tuesdays, you'll find us on Zoom at 7:30 p.m. for Bible study. And end your week with us on Fridays at 7:30 p.m. for a powerful prayer session. Except for the first Friday of the month, which is either our Holy Ghost service or prayer vigil. Thank you for joining us again for another Spirit-filled Sunday service. Any additional announcements will be conveyed to you shortly. And as always, have a great week in the name of the Lord, and may God bless your every step. Peace be with you.
Hallelujah. That announcement video talked about joining the choir, our One Voice. I know there are some of us that have good voices. I know. Some of us, you have heard you sing, even when you talk. Just speaking, you can tell. That just a little bit of pitch to that voice, you will be on fire for God. Just pray. Pray that God will lead you. You know, that God will lead you to step up. And I mean, Brother Caleb is here. He's our minister. He lead here. He trains. If you need some voice to be really tweaked. He can tweak. He tweaks voices. Yes, he mean. Our choir, see, they're awesome. Awesome. This is my little sister. Yeah, my little nephew. They have been phenomenal. And like they said this morning, we're expecting an album soon. And we are waiting. Please be a part of them. I will release that album. It's never too late. And God will bless you in Jesus' name. Also, our evangelism is this week, is this Saturday. That's approaching. Please join us to go out. The word that came today, what God is asking us to do, if we are not doing it, if we are closed-mouthed, if we are tight-lipped, this is being tight-lipped. He has sent us to go out and share him, share his word, share the testimony that you have received, so that others can also benefit. This is one of them. And I pray that God will help us in the mighty name of Jesus. He will give us that grace. Because I remember when I started evangelism, I never liked it. I didn't know what to say. What would I say? But God will fill your mouth. Make yourself available and watch him move. Watch him work. And I pray that the Lord will help us in Jesus' name. So we're going to move ahead now and ask the choir to give us. Our first comer, we welcome you. Please, can you go with Minister Modupe right back there, please? And they welcome you very well. In the first time. Thank you. God bless you.
Let us rise up as we bring the service to a close. Let's sing The Sun Comes Out.
The sun comes out. It's a new day dawn.
It's time.
It's time to sing your song again.
Whatever
may pass, and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the
together, let's say, bless the Lord,
bless the Lord, oh my soul,
hey.
Oh my soul,
oh worship. Rich in love,
you're rich in love, and you're slow to end.
Your name is great,
your name is great, and your heart is high.
For all your goodness,
for all your goodness, I will keep on singing.
Oh,
10,000 reasons. Thank you. King of glory, we honor you, we worship you, we praise your holy name.
Father, we thank you for bringing here us here today. Father, Lord, we pray that all that we have received, mighty God, we shall not lose. In the name of Jesus, we pray that as we go this week, that your grace shall go with us. In the name of Jesus, Father, as we go out there, mighty God, you will be our way maker. In the name of Jesus, be our miracle working God. In the name of Jesus, cause your face to shine upon us. In the mighty name of Jesus, and Lord, we pray that everything that you have deposited in us by your word, mighty God, it shall help us to live our lives better in the name of Jesus. And Father, we pray that we will come back and give you glory. We will come back and give you honor and adoration. In the mighty name of Jesus. Thank you, Ancient of Days, for in Jesus' mighty name we have prayed. Amen. Amen. Jesus.